सेम बट S1 एंड S2 दे आर पॉइंटिंग टू डिफरेंट, दे आर डिफरेंट एंटिटीज ऑल टुगेदर. S1 इज अ लिटरल, S2 इज अ ऑब्जेक्ट, बट डॉट इक्वल्स मेथड विल गिव ट्रू बिकॉज द कंटेंट इज द सेम. सो इन मेनी केसेज यू माइट नॉट वॉन्ट टू यूज न्यू स्ट्रिंग ऑपरेटर एंड इट्स बेटर टू यूज अ स्ट्रिंग लिटरल टू ऑप्टिमाइज योर जावा कोड. Now, how to execute system commands in a Java program? See, many a times we feel the need to execute the system programs from my Java program itself rather than going back to the DOS prompt and then typing the command. So, to achieve this, Java has provided you a class called runtime. So, you can use the syntax runtime.getRuntime method.exec. Using this syntax, you can execute most of the DOS commands or the system commands within your Java class. We will see some examples. So, in this example you see, I am trying to execute the dir, the directory command which gives me the list of all the directories in the C drive. So, I have written runtime.getRuntime.exec cmd /c dir. So, this is a very good way to use most of the system commands within your Java class. So, there are many scenarios in real life where we want to copy a file from one location to another, delete a file, hide a folder, or we want to achieve programmatically rather than going to the DOS prompt and manually typing. To automate such system processes, we use this runtime class. We will see another example. In this example, I am trying to copy a shortcut form from one location to another. So, I've just used the, in my exec, I am passing copy source location space destination location. So, the copy command or the cp command in Unix, copy command in DOS. So, the example is self-explanatory. So, runtime is a very powerful class. Now, we always come across Java reflections. So, when do we actually need this Java reflection? So, whenever we want to get the information of a Java class structure at runtime, then only we need this Java reflection API. So, suppose we have a string class in Java, java.lang.string. So, I know this string class. Now, I want to know what all methods are there in this string class. What all fields are there in this string class? What all constructors are there in the string class? I know string is an inbuilt Java class, but I want to know its properties. So, this is the way we can know these things. Class.forName will give me the class object. Now, from the class object, I can get the list of all the fields by calling getDeclaredFields. We can get the list of constructors by calling getConstructors method. We can get the list of method names by calling getMethods. But the first prerequisite is getting class object for the given class. So we need to just know the name of a class. The class should exist, and then we can get all the properties of that class using the reflection. Now, one of the most important concepts in Java is using the proper Java collections. See, we all know about Java collections. We all know list, set, queue, stack, map, and many other things. But when to use what sometimes confuses even the most seasoned Java programmers. So, I created some thumb rules. You can follow these thumb rules and you can know when to use what. List maintains the order, it allows the duplicates. So when do you want me to use list? You want to use array list or linked list whenever you want to store or iterate through a bunch of things. One of the most common scenario is, suppose you have a result set and you want to retain the order of insertion. then you can use a list data structure. You can either use array list or linked list. Set. In case of set, the order is not significant and it does not allow duplicates. So when do we want to use set, like a hash set? When will you use that? So whenever you want to make a yes no decisions about an item, you already have a set of unique items in a bucket and you want to know whether that item exists or not, like whether this item belongs to this database, whether a particular word in a dictionary is a word of English or not. Scenarios like this, real life scenarios, you want to implement set, example hash set. Now when do you want to use map? We all know that map is a data structure with key value pairs. So whenever you have a problem scenario, like for a given value x or for a given key x, what is the y? Example, I'll give you an example, like of suppose there is a list of users and their addresses. So for a given user ID, what is the bank account information? Such type of scenarios, you always try to use map, like a hash map or a tree map. So now you are clear when to use list, when to use set, and when to use map. Now from my past years of experience, I have come across this thumb rule. By default, always try to use array list. Use only linked list when it is really needed to use. Because in case of array list, the performance by and large is always better than linked list. Array list allows the elements to be more efficiently retrieved by using index. So normally we always try to retrieve the values or data by index, and hence array list is the right choice. Using timers in Java. We can use java.util.timer to schedule a task. So basically timer in Java, the timer class is used to act like a scheduler to automate a task. Suppose I want a task to run at 12 o'clock in the midnight every day. So I've taken an example where I'm trying to schedule a task to execute every 5 seconds. So you can see I've used java.util.timer and java.util.timerTask. These two classes are important. So I've just created an instance of timer class, timer, timer. And then I'm calling a schedule method, timer.schedule. And I have three arguments. One is the task which I want to automate. And I have two arguments. One is the task I want to automate, and the second is for how many seconds, after how many seconds I want to automate. So you can just use this schedule method to automate any task. So in this example, you see I have passed 5 as an argument because every 5 seconds I want to automate the task. Now another important concept in Java is how to create a thread dump from a JVM. See, it's very important to understand whenever you are using multi-threading, how does JVM work? Or suppose you create thousands of threads in a banking application. Can you keep track of those 1,000 threads? No. But there is a way. By using thread dump, you can know which thread is using how much memory, which thread is active, which thread is in waiting state and all that. So one way to get a thread dump is getting the process ID of your Java process, or the PID. Now we all know that in Unix there is a command called ps -el -pipe grep java. So by using this command I can get the process ID of my Java process in this example. And in Windows it's very simple, just open the task manager and see the process ID of the Java process. The second step is to request a thread dump from the JVM now. So there is a tool called JStack which you can directly use at the command prompt, JStack space the process ID space the log file. So whatever is the output of this JSPAC utility, it goes to a log file, and you can view in the log file what all threads are there, how many, like suppose your current thread is Java process or whatever current process is there, how much memory it is using, and all those information or I will say metrics you can get. One alternative to get a thread jump is using the JConsole tool. Many of you must be familiar with this JConsole tool. So using the JConsole tool, द सेम टाइम दिस कैन लीड टू कॉन्करेंसी इश्यूज बट इफ ऑल योर गेटर एंड सेटर मेथड्स आर सिंक्रोनाइज्ड दिस विल मेक द क्लासेस थ्रेड सेफ. You can also use the volatile keyword for thread safety. See, by using the volatile keyword, like in the given example, I've declared a variable x and use the volatile keyword before it. Means, whenever multiple threads are trying to access the value of this variable, they will always get the correct and the latest value, and there will be no dirty reads or concurrency issues. Most of the times in practical scenarios, whenever we design a Java class, we try to make the setter method as private. Or suppose I have a Java class called bank, okay, and I have two methods, read account and update account. Now read account will not give me any problem, but update account might give me concurrency issues if multiple threads are trying to update the same account at the same time. So what I can do, the write methods in our applications or the setter methods or the methods like update, we can make them as private so that they are not accessible to the outside world. So it depends on us whether to make a write operation as private or whether to make a write operation as synchronized, whether to make both read and write operations as synchronized to achieve thread safety. It depends on case to case basis. It depends on our need. Another way to achieve thread safety in Java is using the final keyword, which is the most simplest solution. We know that a final class cannot be subclassed. A final method cannot be overridden. A final variable in Java is static, constant. So the final keyword preserves the value of the variable even if multiple threads are trying to access it and it cannot be modified. So these are the various aspects which I wanted to discuss today. We already lost some of the time, so I was quickly going through the slides. Later, once you download, once you see the videos, you can always go through the examples code. I have not explained each line of the example, but I have explained the concept behind it, when to serialize, when to synchronize, which data structure to use. If you are clear with all these basics, if you understand the scenario, if you understand which API of Java to use when, how to optimize your Java code, then you will overcome most of the problems faced by the performance of a Java application. Of course, you can use tools like static code compilers, dynamic code analyzers, JProbe, JProfiler, find bugs, PMD check style. All these tools are very helpful, but the important concept is these tools will not correct your code. They will only identify the bugs. You should know why your code is giving a problem. You should analyze the log file. You should take a thread dump. You should see the heap size. You should understand and then optimize your Java code accordingly.